Hi everyone and welcome! Remember the 486 Rocket Blaster? It was one of the first projects I presented on this channel. It's basically an interposer adapter board for 486 CPUs that allows you to plug in a 3.3V CPU to a 5V only motherboard. It works really well, but it's not super easy to put together. There are two reasons for this. First, it requires very precise soldering since the pins on both sides of the PCB are very close together and the solder pads are very small. Second, if you do make a mistake while soldering the pins, you have to find it and fix it right away, because there's no way to fix it later as the solder points get covered by the headers of the opposite side of the board. I got feedback from several people, including Eric from the Retro Eric channel, sharing their experience with building one and pointing out the high failure rate. So I decided to redesign the adapter with ease of assembly in mind, and came up with this sandwich design. The adapter requires the use of two boards that connect to each other through standard 2.54mm headers. The solder points are now always accessible, so you can fix any soldering mistake at any point during the assembly process. The solder pads are now larger, and the whole thing should be a lot easier to solder and put together. This design allows us to use an actual 168-pin PGA socket instead of the single-row receptacles that had to be used in the old design. Please note that the new board will only accept the small-size mini buck converters that are 18mm by 12mm, because of lack of space. I've also added solder pads for a modern linear regulator circuit based on the AP7176B chip, which can be used instead of the mini buck converter. Okay, let's put it together. The first thing to note is that both the top and bottom boards are identical, but we need to set a few solder jumpers differently depending on whether the board is going to be at the top or at the bottom of the adapter. The solder jumper settings are listed on the silk screen. The board on the left will be at the top of the adapter, so we short pads 2 and 3. The board on the right will be at the bottom of the adapter, so we short pads 1 and 2. Now let's attach the pin headers on the bottom board. They need to stay flat, so I'm using the CPU as a flat surface. At this point I made a mistake, but I didn't realize it until later. The voltage regulator circuit should be at the top board of the adapter, not the bottom one. But I'll show you how I soldered it anyway. The voltage regulator chip has a heat dissipation pad at the bottom, which has to be soldered first before we solder the pins. But how do we solder such pads which are under the chip using a soldering iron? The solution is to provide a way to heat that pad indirectly, by heating a nearby pad that has good heat connectivity with that pad under the chip. I designed the board with two such helper pads, one at the top, right below the chip, and one at the bottom, right underneath the chip. This time, I'm heating the pad right under the chip, so I have to place the soldering iron at the bottom side of the board. Once the chip's ground pad is soldered, we can proceed with soldering the pins. I will fix my mistake and I will move the components from the bottom board to the top board later in the video. Now let's solder the receptacles where the top board will connect to. Now let's move to the top board. It is at this point that I realized my mistake. The voltage regulator circuit should be the top board, not the bottom. So let's try again. I desoldered the components from the bottom board off camera. This time I'm going to solder the ground pad of the chip by hitting the pad at the top. Okay, now we can attach the PGA socket. These decoupling SMD capacitors help with the stability of the voltage going into the CPU. They are a bit fiddly to solder, and the one at the bottom side needs extra care because it has to be positioned at an angle to avoid shorting one of the pins. Now let's attach the headers that will connect to the bottom board. And we're ready! Let's try it out! No postcodes! But the CPU gets somewhat warm, which suggests that it's being powered. Oh, I just realized that I forgot to solder these pins. Let's try again. And success! Let's measure the voltage using the middle header. And yeah, we're getting 3.4 volts, just as expected. Now let's run some software using this ISA VGA card. The CPU gets recognized as a DX4 at 60 MHz. Doom runs super slow. The linear voltage regulator circuit seems to be doing a fairly good job. After going through the manual for this board, I realized that some jumpers were set wrong. The board was using the wrong bus frequency. After fixing the jumpers, we're getting 100 MHz, just as expected. But the performance seems quite low. There is no L2 cache in this board, but this should not have such great impact. I could not find out what was wrong with this board. It seemed to work fine with a different 5V DX266 CPU. So I tried out my fancy Soyo SY4SAW2 after configuring it to provide 5V at the socket. Now the performance looked correct. But Doom was still very slow. But this is probably due to the slow ISA graphics card, so I replaced it with a VLB graphics card instead. And yeah, it is way faster now. Finally, I wanted to test the adapter on an older 5V only board, the same one I was using in my original 486 Socket Blaster videos. But I was running into instabilities at 100 MHz. In the Doom demo, the guy was not following the predetermined path and was getting stuck. I've had similar issues in the past, caused by a ripple in the voltage, so I decided to remove the onboard voltage regulator and try the mini buck converter instead. I set it to around 3.6 volts. But I was still getting instabilities in Doom. This time the whole computer was hanging. This issue went away when I reduced the multiplier from 3x to 2.5x. The original Socket Blaster adapter was rock solid on this specific test and on this exact board with this exact CPU. This makes me wonder if this is a voltage regulation issue or some other issue related to the longer distance between the CPU and the socket. Anyway, that's all for today. The sources and Gerber files for the Sandwich Socket Blaster are available on GitHub, so feel free to experiment with it. I will try to investigate the instability issue further, but in the meantime, feel free to share any ideas or suggestions you may have in the comments. I hope you enjoyed the video, and as always, thanks for watching and goodbye.